ओम सदा शिव समारंभाम् शंकराचार्य मध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंताम् वंदे गुरु परंपराम्। ओम वक्रतुंड महाकाय सूर्यकोटि समप्रभ निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणी विद्यारंभम करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। सो वी विल फर्स्ट इंट्रोड्यूस अवर सेल्स। मेनी ऑफ यू मे बी न्यू टू आर्षविद्या वर्षिणी। So we are all students of Swami Dayananda Saraswati. Swamiji was a great Vedanta teacher, and he conducted many Vedanta courses starting from 1971 onwards till 2014. And we are all students of Swamiji. We have attended long-term residential course with Swamiji for 3.5 years. And on the command of Swamiji to fulfill his wishes, so he asked us to start a Gurukulam similar to where we studied. So we all studied in Arshavidya Gurukulam, Anaikatti, which is near Coimbatore. And later on, Swamiji asked us to start a Gurukulam similar to that. So we have now established a trust, and we have acquired some land, and we are also building a Gurukulam right now. But before the construction completes, we have started online classes so that we can at least benefit the students who wishes to join our classes. So right now we are conducting online classes in Vedanta, Sanskrit, chanting like this in many different topics again. And again, we are also conducting classes in both Tamil and English, and for adults and children. All types of classes we are already conducting online. Now, this is the this class is essentially we have conceived for introducing our dharma to the newer generation, because this generation, or even from my generation, let me say, we were not ready to just listen to something just because our parents are saying that. Okay, so we are not ready to listen or do something just because our parents or grandparents did it, or they ask us to do it. We all asked. Even I used to question my grandmother, grandfather, or even my own father, why I have to do something? Is it meaningful? All these questions are there, correct? So we want to answer all these questions, which are, we think, very valid. Any child or any young person today can have all these questions, and we as a generation who are older to them, we have a duty to answer all these questions so that all of you can become a dharmika, let us say, those who are following our dharma. Not just because you are believing something or because we told you to do it, but out of your own conviction. So you have to understand the vision behind our way of life, and then you can follow it with your own conviction. In fact, our tradition has always been like that. So that is what we want to do. And we have three teachers here. We'll be conducting classes on and off. Different teachers may conduct some class. So we are planning to have 16 classes of 1 hour each. So myself is, I am Jai Shankar. So I am a pass out from IIT BHU. So I was a software engineer, and I met my guru in US, and then I became interested to study Vedanta. So later on, I came back to India and studied as a residential student, and then I have been now teaching Vedanta, Sanskrit, our Dharma for more than 20 years now. Kalyan Kumar also is my batchmate from my engineering college, and later on we both came together to study with Swamiji, and Kalyan also has been teaching Vedanta and Sanskrit to interested students for a long time now. Sri Vidya is my wife, and she is also a student of Pujya Swamiji. She also studied in the same course with us, and she has been now conducting lot of classes both in Tamil and English, and to adults and children. So we are the main founders also of Arshavidya Varshini, and we will be the teachers during this course for all of you. Okay, now a little bit I'll just show you the photos of the Gurukulam which is under construction. So we have got 9.5 acres land in Tirunelveli district near Kalidai Kurichi, which is like on the banks of the river Tamrapurni. And so this is the proposed Gurukulam entrance, and we have built a big goshala here. We are having 29 cows, and we can have another 40-50 more cows also here. So we are having all desi cows in our goshala. This is our temple. In fact, the first slide where you saw Vallabha Mahaganapati, Sharadamba, Adi Shankara, they are here in this temple. This is the temple where we have done Pratishtha of the three devatas. These are all our cows. Just to give you some idea, we have got some Gir cows from Gujarat also, and local breed cows also here. So this is just to give you an idea where we are. In fact, right now I'm talking from Kalidai Kurichi only, from the village which is almost near Kanyakumari, in fact, in south. So the technology has improved so much now that we can be in this village and still reach all of you who are all joining from all over the world, I think. So now let us go to the topic itself. A little bit I would like to introduce, what do we mean by Sanatana Dharma, Sanatana Hindu Dharma also we have to add, because the word Hindu also has been popularized now, and it is there for a few centuries now, in fact. So Dharma itself is generally translated as religion in English, but that may not be an appropriate translation. So how do we understand dharma? Means dharma in Sanskritam comes from the root dhru. Dhru is the dhatu or the root. Now dhru means, from that the verb dharati comes. Dharati, dharti also in Hindi is there, correct? Dharti means what? The earth is called dharti actually, correct? So dharati means what? Support. The one which holds or supports. So earth is the one which is supporting all our life, correct? That's why it is called dharti, I think, in English also. That which supports life, or that which makes this entire universe what it is, which sustains it, that is called actually dharma. In at a very high level, if we look at the word dharma, dharma means that which supports the life and the entire universe as it is. That order, we can say, is what is called as dharma. Because we see a certain order here, that is why we are even able to study it, correct? Science also is a quest for knowledge and a quest for truth, we can say. We are trying to understand the truth behind the objective universe which we are living in. And how are we able to study scientifically? Because there is a certain order. Because that is why there are laws are there, correct? there are physical laws are there. So all of you would have studied basic science, even things like Boyle's law, let us say, Charles law. These are all basic things. I increase the temperature, then pressure also goes up with a certain, you know, with a certain proportion, let us say. Now these things are all there in the same manner, correct? Or we can even study science because we say that any object which is falling towards the earth is accelerating at a particular rate. So there is a gravitation is there. Now it is the same thing. If it changes all the time, then there is no order, correct? It will be chaotic. Today, if the gravitation force is in one manner, next minute if it changes, then we cannot really build any machines, anything. Understand that. So, in fact, scientists say there are many constants in this world, they say, in the universe. And even if those constants change their value by a very minuscule percent, let us say, or even one decimal point changes, the whole world may not be there. That's how it is. The physical laws have to be so precise based on certain constants, Planck's constant, like that, many are there, basic things. So that means there is a certain order. Unless these constants remain constant, that is the order, correct? If the constant becomes a variable, then we cannot even study anything or make anything if everything is chaotic and changing all the time. So there is a certain order in the universe which we have to appreciate. There is a physical order. There is a chemical order also. Correct? We all study chemistry. You put this compound together and it reacts in a certain way always. If it reacts in one way today and reacts in some other way tomorrow, again there is going to be a problem. That will be a disorder. But there is a chemical order. There is also biological order is there. So physical order, chemical order, biological order is there. Based on that only, organisms are living, they are reproducing. There is a certain order there. Even physiologically, there is an order. How your body functions. That if you breathe, then there is a certain metabolism in your body. You eat, it is getting digested. All these things are part of the order. So all these things are what which makes life possible, correct? If the order is not there, if everything is chaotic, then there won't have been any life itself in this universe. So we have to appreciate this order which is supporting the whole universe, and that is what makes it even possible to study it systematically and makes it possible for all scientific discoveries and inventions to happen. Now that order is what we call dharma. It's an order is what which is supporting the whole thing, correct? If there is no order, then you cannot have the universe as it is today. So that order is what we call dharma. Now in this order, not only we are talking about all this physical order, chemical order, biological order, there is even a psychological order also is there. If you give certain stimuli to people, they will react in this manner. Even a particular situation, particular upbringing, people are like this. They react in this way. They can, so your behavior also can be predicted to a certain extent. Psychology may not be 100% like a science, but still it is, there are psychological laws are there, order is there, even there. But more than that, there is also a moral order. Because as human beings, whatever we do, correct? We are not programmed like animals. See, animals also are self-conscious. They are also living beings. We respect them for that. But an animal does not have a fully evolved consciousness, we can say. It doesn't have free will like a human being. Animal is more living by its instinct. So it has a certain instinct to eat certain things. It has a certain instinct to reproduce. It also has certain instinct to lead a certain social life within its own group and all that. So at a certain level, it is living its life, but you cannot call that it has a totally evolved free will, or it knows what is right or wrong and all that. If an animal comes and does something to you, you cannot go to court and say that this cow stepped on my feet. So you have to know, you cannot go to the judge and say you have to punish the cow. The judge will say cow does not have any free will. Why did you go and stand near the cow? Or you can, if the cow was free and it ran away somewhere and then it came and attacked you, or a dog attacked you, you cannot put a case on the dog, but you can put a case on the owner of the dog, saying that they were negligent. They did not keep the dog under the leash, whatever. So the animal itself, even in regular law, it is not looked upon as having a certain free will, and it is able to discern what is right or wrong. Animals are going by their own instinct only. So you cannot punish the animal also for whatever behavior it is having. But human beings are not like that. So we are living our lives based on what is right and what is wrong. We all have a certain instinctive understanding of, again, what is right, wrong also. And also we have acquired, also based on where you are living, in which country you are living, there are specific moral laws are there. There are generic laws are there. We look into that. What we call Samanya Dharma and Vishesha Dharma, we say. So Dharma is actually, although Dharma in general means all these orders, correct? Starting from physical order, chemical order and all these things. But in usage, it is particularly, it is referring, let us say in common usage, to moral orders or moral laws or righteousness, like this also they translate. So when we say that, are you acting according to Dharma, then what we really mean there is, are you doing things based on what is right in a particular situation? Okay, so are you doing things which are right? Are you avoiding things which are wrong? So right, wrong is very important. And what is right in a situation also is called as Dharma or righteousness. That is what is called. So based on that only, we have certain virtues. As human being, we have a certain virtue. So we have to be truthful. We have to be honest. Like that, many virtues are there. And also the way of living, our way of living also should reflect all these things. Correct? Our own idea of what is righteous has to be reflected in the way we live. So all these things come under, broadly under Dharma. Okay, Dharma means that which supports the order, which supports the life and this entire universe. But more specifically, the moral order. What is right, what is wrong in a particular situation, and what matrix of right, wrong we have to guide us in our way of life. That is also called Dharma. So I hope this is clear. Now our Dharma, when we say, it becomes our way of life, correct? Or Sanatana Dharma it is called, it is eternal. So our values, our idea of what is right, wrong, we say that this is all eternal, it is Sanatana. Sanatana, the word means eternal, means what? It is there forever. Why? Because it has no beginning. There is no single founder for our Dharma. This was the person, this is the person who founded our Dharma. It is not like that. There is no known single founder for our Dharma. It is eternal, it is beginningless, in fact. And as a corollary to that, it will be endless also. That is our belief, at least. So even our popular avatara purushas, correct, deities, Rama, Krishna, they are not the founders of our dharma. Understand that Rama was already born in this dharma only. Rama went to Gurukulam and studied with Vasishtha. Vasishtha was the one who taught Rama, correct? And there is a Yoga Vasishtha. Similarly, Krishna. Rama was born in Treta Yuga, we say, correct? And Krishna was born in Dwapara Yuga. So we have our own understanding of the time also. How vast our understanding of time also we can see some other time. But Krishna was born in Dwapara Yuga, which is according to our understanding now, it is more than 5,000 years back, correct? In Dwapara Yuga, at the end, almost at the beginning of Kali Yuga, at the end of Dwapara Yuga, Krishna was born. But he was also born in this dharma. Krishna, although when we talk about our Hindu dharma, we talk about or we consider Bhagavad Gita like a very important text, correct? But it is only one small portion in Mahabharata, correct? Mahabharata itself is a very huge text. 100,000 verses are there. So you can't imagine that at least it is more than 2,000 years old. That much everybody agrees. How old it is, we don't know. But they have 100,000 verses, they have preserved all these years. There was no printing press, there was no computer, there was nothing, correct? But everything was written in palm leaves or just memorized. So these things were all preserved in an oral tradition. So about our oral tradition also we have to understand. We will see that as we go forward. But Bhagavad Gita is only a part of Mahabharata. And it cannot be considered like a foundational text or anything for our dharma. Although it is talking very important subject matter, but it is one of the texts. So we have a whole library, that's what. So we don't have just one text or anything to go by. In fact, life is not that simple also anyway. So we have a whole library of Vedas, we say. If at all we want to talk about a particular text or anything, we have something called Vedas. It's a body of knowledge. Vedas themselves have 4 different Vedas are there. Within them, there are many branches are there. More than 1,000 are there. So like that, Vedas themselves are very huge body of knowledge. Anantavai Vedaha, like that also it is said. Vedas are limitless actually. But whatever we have right now, which is preserved, also is a big literature is there. So that can be considered as a foundational text. Okay, so we will try to understand what are these Vedas and what is the vision of that Veda and how it is actually helping us lead our day-to-day life now. So this dharma is sanatana, it is eternal. There is no single founder, there is no founding date or anything. And all our avatara purushas, our deities are all already born in this dharma only. Even so, we have certain texts. We have the Vedas, which are called Shruti. Then we have Smritis, different Smritis are there. In that, Itihasa is there. Itihasa is more like, this is how it happened. Itihasa, actually it means. So it is historical, really speaking. So in that we have Ramayana, we have Mahabharata. We have different Puranas are there. There are 18 major Puranas, 18 Upapuranas are there. Then we have Dharma Shastras are there. Within the Veda only we have Veda Anga, we say. 6 parts you can study. And then there are many other traditional disciplines of knowledge. In fact, we can count 18, typically 14 or 18. It is counted as 14 or 18. Ashtadasha Vidyasthana, we say. So like this, our traditional literature and knowledge disciplines are there. A lot is there. All these things, of course, many of them are there in Sanskritam, they are also there in other Indian languages. It may not be possible for you to go through all that even in one lifetime, I think. But at least we can understand the gist of whatever is there. That is what we are trying to present here. Okay. So that it will help you to lead your own life based on the, in the light of that knowledge, whatever traditional knowledge we have. We want you to have a certain conviction based on your own understanding and then follow whatever is our dharma. Also, the word Hindu is now used very widely. Hinduism also they use. Now, Hindu can be derived like this. Him apashabdam dushayati khandayati iti Hindu. So, what does Hindu mean also, you have to understand. So, him dushayati, that is Hindu. Him means apashabdam. Apashabdam means something which is not dharma, you can say that which is not righteous, that which is not proper. So adharma, dushayati, khandayati means one who destroys it. So the one who destroys adharma is Hindu. Like that we can derive, we can give an etymological meaning for the word Hindu. So this also all of you should know, being born in this country and in this culture, we should have a certain understanding about even the words which describe us, correct? So Hindu means him apashabdam dushayati khandayati iti Hindu, or in English, the one who destroys adharma, or that which is not righteous, that person is Hindu. As a Hindu, I am duty bound to uphold whatever is righteous. And that again, we have to understand what is righteous, what is right in a particular situation, how do we decide? That also we will look into. Okay. So now, Sanatana Hindu Dharma means this righteousness, which is eternal. Okay. That is what we mean by that. This eternal, righteous way of living, you can say. In a simple manner in English, if we want to translate it, those who uphold this eternal righteous way of living and those who destroy what is not righteous, those who fight against what is not righteous, they are Hindus, they are the Dharmis. Okay, so like that we can understand. Okay, why do we say Hinduism or Sanatana Dharma is a way of life? Because this way of life was popularized, I think, even by Dr. Radhakrishnan. Radhakrishnan was a very, very popular philosopher, you can say Indian philosopher. He was also the president of India. And also the Teacher's Day, in fact, we celebrate September 5th, which is his birthday. So Dr. Radhakrishnan actually popularized saying that ours is a way of life. So what do we mean by saying we have a way of life? Because everybody has a way of life. That is one thing. But even more than that, when we talk about our dharma, why are we talking about it as a way of life? This is something we have to understand. In contrast to other ideas, also in the world, there are many theologies are there in this world. Many people are also trying to spread their own belief systems. So as a modern global person, we are all exposed to different ideas, different belief systems. So they are all called belief system. Understand that. But we are saying we are way of life. This itself we have to contrast and understand correctly. So on one side, we have many belief systems. And what do they say? If you don't believe me, you will go to hell. Okay, at a high level, this is what they are saying. We have certain beliefs. You have to believe that. Then you become a believer. If you are a believer, then you will go to heaven. If you are not a believer, then you will go to hell. And if you want to go to heaven, you have to follow me. there is some founder, some prophet, somebody is there. Okay, so this is one side. There is one whole set of people who are saying this, correct? But we are talking about way of life. Why? Because for us, the stress is in correct behavior, achara, we say. Achara is important. What you do, whether it is right or wrong, that is what is important for us. What you believe, there in fact we have lot more freedom, I can say. Okay, even though because your belief is also based on your understanding of certain things, your knowledge. Okay, so the belief itself can vary, but your idea of what is right or wrong has to be somewhat same. Okay, and in fact, whatever merit you are going to get while living a certain life is based on your behavior only, how you lead your life, what you do. It is not belief itself is not strictly stressed in our tradition. So this point I hope all of you understand. In fact, we are a knowledge tradition, I would say. We are not a belief system. We are not forcing you to believe in somebody or something or a dogma like that. We are not dogmatic, we can say that. But we are stressing that you have to do the right thing in a given situation. So you should have a certain understanding of what is right and what is wrong. And based on that, if you do the right thing, you get certain merit. If you do the wrong thing, you will get demerit, let us say. Okay, that much is there. But otherwise, what you believe, there you have a lot more freedom. That is why truly we are a pluralistic tradition, you can say. You have a lot of freedom in your belief. In fact, traditionally in India, we have 12 darshanas. Okay. So again, we call it darshana. We don't call it philosophy. So I do not want to use English words and confuse our Indian concepts. Dharma, we have to understand it as dharma. Okay. Similarly, even darshana means it is showing you something. It is a way of seeing things. Okay, that is what is a darshana. And we have 12 darshanas, 12 ways of seeing this world, whether there is a creator or not, and what is the position of an individual in this creation. All these things, different darshanas are talking about all these things. Because any darshana has to talk about at least three things, correct? One is yourself as an individual. What is your reality? How you can be happy, because everybody wants to be happy. So every darshana talks about how to make you happy, one. But also they have to talk about you are living in this world, correct? So how did this world come about? Is the world a creation or not? And then if the world is a creation, is there a creator? What is the nature of that creator? These things also one has to understand. So all darshanas have to talk about you as an individual, about this world, and about the creator of the world, if there is one, and how you are, these three are related, and at the end of the day, how you can become happy, free from all sorrow, and be always happy. This is what all these darshanas are talking about. These 12 darshanas again are divided into astika darshana and nastika darshana. Okay, so there are 6 nastika darshana. Nastika and astika here. Astika is wrongly translated in English as an atheist. Okay, so astika means not an atheist really. Astika means one who accepts the Veda. One who accepts whatever the Veda says is considered to be an astika. One who rejects the Vedic knowledge entirely. And they have their own whatever theories, propositions. They are all called Nastika. So in the Nastika Darshana, we have Charvaka. We start with Charvakas. They are called materialist in English. You can say that. Then we have different types of Buddhists. And we also have Jainas. Jains are all there. These four types of Buddhists, the Jainas and the Charvakas, the materialists are called Nastika because they do not accept the Veda. Then there are six more darshanas are there. Starting from, you have Nyaya Vaisheshika, we say. So Nyaya is a darshana. Nyaya in English is translated as logicians. But they are a group of people who are realists. They take this world and then they try to explain the world based on inference. Inference is the main thing, but they also accept the Veda. Then Vaisheshikas are the original atomic theorists in the world. Understand that. Many of you may have studied in your school that Dalton is the one who created the atomic theory and all that. Dalton's theory of atom, whatever, atoms. But Dalton, before some 2000 years before Dalton only, our Vaisheshikas, they are the ones who talk about the whole world is made up of atoms. They call it Anu. So Anu, Paramanu, they say. Paramanu is not even visible. Paramanu, then two Paramanus come together and become Dvanu, they say. That is more like a molecule, correct? And then three Dvanuks come together and become a Trenuk. And the Trenuk only is visible. Like that, they are the original atomic theories. Everything is made up of atoms. And atoms come together and then this whole world, this whatever macro world we are seeing is formed. Like that, they are the original atomic theories. And so they divide the whole world into certain categories. And then once you understand all these things, they say that you will gain happiness. If you have the right knowledge, all these darshanas, they stress on knowledge. According to their system, if you understand and know things properly, then you can overcome all sorrow. You can always be happy. That is the promise. Okay, so there is a Nayayika, there is a Vaisheshika, and there are also Yoga, Sankhya and Yoga, we say. So the Sankhya again has his own theory model, how the world came about. They talk about three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas. Okay. And these three gunas come together, they mix together, and then that's how this whole world is formed. And they stress on all sorts of yogic practices, correct? How to really cultivate a certain type of mind, certain disposition, and how you have to lead a life so that you have a contemplative mind. A mind which can focus on things, a mind which is calm, which is free from all distractions. Like this, the Sankhya focuses more on mental disciplines. Okay. And if you follow all those disciplines, they say that you will have a mind which is free from all thoughts. And that itself is going to give you great happiness. All sorrow is because your mind is thinking in a certain way. Correct? All sorrow is really mental, in fact. It's all based on your thoughts, your thought pattern, how you think. So you think in a certain way and then only become sorrowful or sad. So the Sankhya is focusing more on mental disciplines so that you can then totally have your mind under your mastery. And Yoga also is basically borrowing everything from Sankhya, but they also accept that there is a creator. See, the Sankhya and Vaisheshika, in fact, they do not accept that there is a Ishvara, there is a creator. Okay, because the Vaisheshika says all the Anus come together and form the whole world. The Sankhya also says that all this, the three Gunas, they come together and form this world. So they don't see a need for a creator or an Ishvara. So even the Astika Darshanas are there, which do not accept Ishvara. That's what you have to understand. But Yoga accepts an Ishvara, but they basically borrow everything from Sankhya. And so Yoga is now very popular. Yoga as a physical discipline. But Yoga is not just a physical discipline or only with the physical asanas. Asana is one part. So Yoga actually has Ashtanga, 8 parts to it. Okay. That is what is called Ashtanga Yoga. in that there is a niyama, yama and niyama, correct? Certain acts are prescribed, you have to do certain things. Even here, doing achara is very important for yoga again. And certain things you have to avoid, you should not do. So yama niyama are basically do's and don'ts. And then asana. Asana is the one which is more popular nowadays as yoga. Asana is to keep your body fit, flexible, that you can sit in a place and contemplate. Sitting in one place for 1 hour also is not very easy, correct? The two modern people who are used to chairs, you can't sit cross-legged on the ground. Even for that, you have to be a yogi, I think. So this asana is one part, and then the other parts are all there. Okay, pranayama means how breath control, how do you control your breathing. In fact, that also will keep you very healthy, your mind also. Your the way to master your mind is through your breath. So pranayama is very, very important, the regulating of your breath, how we breathe. In fact, our whole life is looked upon as so many number of breaths. That's how traditionally it is looked upon also. So by regulating your breathing, you are actually also regulating your life itself. So pranayama is an important part of yoga. Then we have pratyahara, dharana, dhyana, samadhi and all that. Those are all more related to your mind. How to focus your mind, how to make your mind one-pointed, how to resolve your mind itself. Because normally we have a cognition of an object and there is a subject, correct? There is a subject, object, division is there. As a knower, you are knowing something, correct? You see a part. So this is part means there is part knowledge. You are the knower of the part, correct? This is part, I know the part. Like that, I am the knower of the part. Part is an object. I am the subject who is knowing the part. So this division itself can be resolved. Okay, and that is a very desirable state. That's what the yogi says. In fact, that resolution also happens every night when we sleep. Understand that. But this is different. This resolution happens when your mind is still awake. There the mind itself resolves and goes to sleep. But even sleep is a very desirable thing, correct? We all like to sleep well. It is rejuvenating. We enjoy the sleep really. That's why nobody goes to the doctor and complains, "Doctor, I get good sleep every night. Please give me some medicines or anything." Nobody asks. In fact, if you don't get sleep, you go to the doctor and you have insomnia. They give you a name. You are an insomniac and you have to do something or take medicines and all that. But otherwise, sleep also is very desirable. But again, there also the subject-object resolves. But in samadhi also, which is the goal of a yogi, the subject-object resolves, your mind is still, but your mind is still awake. That is considered to be what has to be achieved. Like that, the Sankhya and yoga are more towards mental disciplines. And through that, they are saying that you can. Of course, yoga also brings in all other disciplines, as I told you, in the eightfold manner. And if you lead a life with all these disciplines, you will be happy. See, all these darshanas are only talking about how to keep you happy, which is what everybody really wants. And then we also have Purva Mimamsa and Uttara Mimamsa, we say, or Vedanta. So Purva Mimamsa is a Vaidika. He lives the life as per whatever the Veda says. And Veda is telling you to do so many different things, rituals, karma, we call it. So on a day-to-day basis, you are supposed to do Nitya Karma, we say. Every day you are supposed to do certain things. Then on certain occasions, like let us say a new moon day, a full moon day, or an eclipse, Naimittika, we say. On certain occasions also, you are expected to do many things. So like this, and also based on your desire, also you can do. So I want to rule this whole world as a Chakravarti. Means there are, Veda is telling you to do certain karma, or you want to go to heaven. heaven itself, I don't want to use the word, we can say swarga. So the Veda talks about different lokas also. So if you want to go to swarga, then you do this karma, you do this every day, or you do this during this time, like this. So the Veda is like a supermarket. The initial portion of the Veda, we can say, or most of the Veda, which is called Karma Khanda, the section where the karma is talked about, for different types of desires, to achieve different ends, to achieve different things, what kind of rituals you can do, what karma you can do, what activities you have to do, all that is detailed out. Okay, that is called Purva Mimamsa. And surprisingly, the Purva Mimamsaka also does not feel a need for an Ishvara. In fact, the Purva Mimamsaka does not accept the world as a creation itself. He says within the world, different things are getting created and destroyed, but the world as it is always there like this. So unless you accept the world as a creation, you don't require a creator, correct? So the Purva Mimamsaka, even though he is a Vaidika, he is like, he is accepting the Veda for everything. He leads his life, entire life, as per the whatever is said in the Veda, and he does not accept a creator. But then there is a Vedantin also, one who goes by not only whatever is said in the Purva Bhaga, or the initial section of the Veda, but there is a final section of the Veda also is there, Vedanta, the end of the Veda, where the reality about this world, about oneself, all this is talked about. And knowing our own reality alone can free us from all sorts of sorrow, sadness, and make us always happy. So that is the Vedanta. So like this, we have all these darshanas, and all the darshanas are again teaching you something. They are not asking you to blindly believe something, this or that. They are all asking you to understand their model and also follow your life. They are also giving you certain disciplines so that you can internalize this knowledge and assimilate it and lead your life according to that and see whether it really helps you or not. So that is why our stress is on knowledge. We do not have a belief system. That is why it is very difficult to go. We cannot go to the road and preach like some others do. Okay. We don't have a simple set of some 10 beliefs or anything like that. That if you believe that is good enough, you will go to Swarga or heaven. No, it's not like that. That is why, in fact, you have to make an effort to understand our traditional knowledge systems. Unless you make an effort to understand it, it is very difficult. Okay. Without knowledge, again, you will not, everything will look meaningless to you. So in this, whatever few weeks, few hours, we are trying to give you a background knowledge so that you will be better equipped to understand the meaning behind whatever we have in our day to day, because everything is a form. We cannot just, unless you understand the spirit behind the form, whether it's a cultural form or a religious form, you cannot do it with certain commitment. So that's what we are trying to give you here. So since it is the stress is on knowledge, we have a Guru Shishya Parampara. Not only Guru Shishya Parampara, you have to go to a Gurukulam and learn. Or even your own family traditions are all there. Your elders in your family also are teaching you so many things. So we have to learn many things and understand them properly. But somewhere with modern education and school, going to school and all that, there has been a certain disruption in this. And that is also we are trying to bridge here. Okay, that's what we are trying to bridge here. So again, our dharma covers everything in our day-to-day life. Okay, so we have our own way of eating food, what we eat, and when we eat what, all these things are also there. How we dress, our music is there. There is a classical music, there are folk musics, there are so many traditions are there in that. Our dance also, again, everywhere there is a Deshi and Margi, we say. Okay, so the Margi is the classical and Deshi are all folk. Both are celebrated. So we have music, dance, art, architecture, wonderful temples. And they all had a lot of knowledge on how to build it. In fact, whatever they have built, it is surveying for hundreds of years. The new buildings we build now do not last so long. So they had a certain knowledge which we have to appreciate that. Then their views on politics, who should rule, how they should rule, what kind of character a public person should have. There are a lot of guidelines there. Literature, we have so much, in fact, in all languages also, not just Sanskritam. And how do we socialize? Our social life, everything is guided by our dharma, our sense of what is right, what is wrong. So that is very important. And as I told you, there is a samanya dharma and a vishesha dharma. Samanya dharma means universal values. Universally, we know certain things are right and wrong. For example, I expect everybody should tell truth to me. Correct? And I also know that everybody else also expects the same thing. That means I must also tell the truth then. Correct? That is a universal value. This is what we call in English as golden rule and all that. So I have to behave in the way in which I expect others to behave towards me. So whatever I expect from others, that they should always tell truth, they should always be kind towards me, they should help me. All these things are there. That means you also have to be similar to others because they also have similar expectation like what you expect. So you have certain expectations from others and they also have the same expectation from you. Now this is known to all of us and that itself becomes a basis for what we call Samanya Dharma. Nobody has to teach you this. Understand that. Dharma need not be taught explicitly. Of course, there can be confusion in a particular situation, what is right, wrong, then you are supposed to take guidance of your elders, of your guru. But otherwise, in general, dharma is something which is there. That is what we call conscience and all that. Within you only, you know, instinctively, you know what is right, wrong. And samanya dharma particularly, universal values are there. Okay, not only with reference to our human beings, even with reference to animals also, there is a samanya dharma is there. So we have ahimsa, non-violence, satyam, truthfulness. These are all samanya dharma, universally applicable. But of course, it has to be applied in a particular situation, particular context. Contextually, there can be variations. That is what is called vishesha dharma. Contextually, what is right, wrong also we have to see. A doctor who is a surgeon cannot say that I am ahimsavadi, I will not cut the body, it is violence, blood will come, I will not take the knife. A surgeon cannot say that, correct? Because we also have to see what is the greater good. That is where the context is coming. So vishesha dharma is there always, samanya dharma also is there. We will discuss these two things also in more detail as we go forward. And also, this vishesha dharma can be based on desha and kala, place and time. So in India, driving on the left is right. If I go to US, driving on the left is wrong. In fact, I have to be keep right, correct? Keeping right there is right. Keeping left here is right. Keeping right here is actually wrong. Now all these things, you cannot say, go to US and say, no, I'm an Indian, I won't follow your rules. That they will not accept, correct? So you have to follow certain rules, certain regulations as per the whatever place and time. That is also very important. That is also bringing in a certain context to what is right and wrong. So all these things we have to take into account. So now we have talked about our dharma as a matrix of values which are guiding us in our day-to-day life. And also our dharma also should be based on our the knowledge which is being taught to us by these different darshanas. But in this, we have to understand that there is a certain vision. So our entire way of life is based on a certain vision. And what is that vision? We have to understand very clearly. Only then our way of life will be meaningful. So that is what we are trying to focus hereafter. So I will stop here. So we will continue tomorrow with that vision. Okay, that is the one we want to continue with. Now, if I have some time, many of you have raised your hands and you have also sent many messages on the chat, I think. Let me just see the chat messages. And okay, some of you have asked some questions. Let me see whether I can answer at least a couple of sessions, a couple of questions. Okay, in which yuga do we live? So we have, traditionally we have a concept of four yugas or Chatur Yuga. There is a Satya Yuga, there is a Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga and Kali Yuga. So this Yuga is called Kali Yuga. And also the how many years are there in each of these Yugas. Also there are, in the Puranas it is all talked about, it is a very huge number. Okay, let us say that our idea of time closely matches whatever even the modern scientists are saying, that what is the age of this universe and all that. In billions of years, it is coming. Okay. So that much I will tell now. Rest of the details we will see as we go forward. And okay. Where Advaita and Dvaita? We will see that later. One person has asked about Dvaita and Advaita. There is also Vishishta Advaita. All of these things we will answer when we come to the vision. Okay, given that most of our Vedas scriptures are not in written form and have been passed down orally, how did we maintain the integrity? See, the integrity first depends on the words itself, correct? If the words change, the meanings and all will change. So how did our forefathers maintain the whatever the Shabda Rashi, we say the group of words which are there in the oral tradition? That is why we have different pathas. See, you go to a Veda Pathashala and learn the Veda, the normal chanting you will learn first. That is called Samhita Patha. As it is, however you have to chant based on, there is a certain swara also, correct? So, there is a certain swara based on that you have to learn. There is a certain tune, you can say. Then, you have something called Krama Patha. Each word you will learn, word by word. Then there is a Pada Pata, Ghana Pata, like that, different types of Jata, Gana and all that. More and more complicated. So, first word, second word. Second word, third word. Third word, fourth word, like that you will learn, chant. That is one Pata. Okay, the Gana Pata is the most complicated. So, first, second, second, first. 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1. 1, 2. Then 2, 3. 2, 3, 4. 4, 3, 2. Like that they will chant. It's a very complicated way of chanting. But by keeping all these different types of patha, the words themselves can never be lost. It is like a tape recorder. That is an amazing way of preservation. In fact, UNESCO is considering that as a heritage, world heritage. This Vedic chanting, how it has been preserved, and the way it has been preserved orally in different pathas, it is a heritage of the whole world. Okay, that's how they have done it. That's why it is still there. There were so many invasions, so many people were killed, and libraries were burnt. It was burning for weeks, in fact. Nalanda and all, when they burnt it, it was burning for weeks. But people ran away, and it is all there in their head because it's an oral tradition. That's what has survived. Even then we have lost so much, but so much has survived now. Whatever has survived, only if you want to study it, one lifetime is not enough, let me tell you. So, again, somebody is asking the name of the person who discovered Anu. Again, there is no individual name and all that. There is a Vaisheshika Sutra. Okay, Kanada is the Rishi. But even there, if you see in most of our texts, they'll say we are only codifying or bringing it into a certain text form, whatever was already there. So we don't know who is one person and all that. It is all Arsham. We say it is coming from different rishis. We don't know which rishi. Or we know a certain rishi who wrote a defining text. But that rishi in the text itself may say that I am only just summarizing whatever was already there. It is like that. But Kanada is the rishi who wrote the Vaisheshika Sutra. There only this atomic theory is talked about. Correct? I talked about the Anu, Paramanu and all that. That is the original atomic theory. They are the original materialists, like the current scientists. They also talk about the world as made up of atoms and all that, and that is how this macro world is made. And so which rishi heard the Ved? There are so many rishis are there, in fact. That's why when we chant a Vaidika mantra, Veda mantra, we always remember the rishi, the chandas, the meter in which it is there, and the devata on which that mantra is there. Okay, we always have to remember these three things before we chant any mantra. That tradition is there. And there are so many rishis are there. Many of them are women also, not just men. Understand that. So like this, so I think now we have almost reached the time. Some more questions are coming. We will take it up. We will note down all your questions and maybe going forward, we will try to answer many of these things also. Okay. So we'll close it here today. And maybe I'll unmute all of you for some time. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnamidachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamidivavasthate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Guruji.